presentation will be mainly focused on effective communication skills. And I think this, especially communication, is so important. And I think it's very crucial for the recovery process, and especially for addicts and their families, because you know, the family obviously is a system, and if there isn't communication, then it becomes a concern, and you know, there isn't anyone or one of the family members hearing another one, and becomes problematic and even chaotic. And I think communication is so important, because we know that where addiction is concerned, there would be a lot of like misunderstandings and conflicts within the family. So I think good or healthy communication skills, you know, it's there to obviously help the family address and resolve these conflicts that are currently even tensions that would be existing in the family. And I think communication is a big part of the recovery process as well, because how are you going to learn about what your loved one is going through if there isn't communication? No one is willing to listen to anyone that is speaking or going through something. So I think it's very, very important in that regard. And I know that oftentimes what would happen is that when family members are struggling to communicate with each other, oftentimes we would assume that the next person knows how I feel. And I think the most typical one that we know, we see a lot, Cheryl, is maybe a family member would post something on WhatsApp, like a screenshot, and would hope that the next person would see it. And I think sometimes you'd see like silent treatment, with hopes that the next person would know how you're feeling or what's happening with you, or even like avoiding them. So I think that those are some of the ways of you know, that shows that there is unhealthy communication that is currently existing you know, in the family. So there is this quote that says that if you haven't said it, don't expect them to know it. Communication is much easier than mind reading. So yeah, I think it's so important to communicate how you feel and where you're at, and don't expect that the next person will read your mind. So I think it's a very big one. And I think yeah, as I said, I think communication, it's very important, because then you're able to understand where the significant other is at emotionally or even psychologically. So especially in recovery, I think there's a lot of like emotions that take place even in families, in terms of how the addict or the loved one would make the family feel. And I think in that regard, all the family or the system is able to communicate. So I think the goals for this presentation, the goals for this presentation is to just be able to learn different styles of communicating. And I think just to learn the styles and how to, you know, practically, you know, practically apply them in your daily lives. And I think just how communication is relevant in addiction. And I think we are going to also talk about some psychological theories that are relevant to communication as far as addiction is, you know, concerned. So oftentimes I think we ask ourselves, what's the role of communication? So I think communication plays a significant, you know, part, especially in recovery, in a sense that, you know, it's able to build trust, in a sense that there would be effective communication and trust and openness, in a sense that if, you know, I'm a loved one that is in recovery and I'm struggling, if there is a space that is offered to me to communicate, then there is also that trust as well. I think oftentimes some of the things that I hear in session, Cheryl, that patients would mention is that, you know, I've never been offered like a space where I don't feel like judged. So I think, or maybe I'm actually mentioning this thing to you for the first time, and I think it's quite concerning, in a sense that, I mean, like, you have a family member, then I think you tend to wonder what is currently happening in the system. Is it because maybe mom or dad or the sister, they're not approachable, or what's really happening? So I think that's why this presentation was so important, so that we can hear each other in the family. And I think its role is to provide, I think, emotional support, whereby if I can talk to my mom or my sister, then I'm able to share if I'm not okay or I had a bad day, rather than often not sharing and internalizing that, and, you know, ending up dealing with those emotions in a more disruptive manner, which is maybe going to use substances. So I think it's really, really important for us to be aware of such. I think offering just that space, it's like, I think you'd be surprised on how much significance that could bring. And I think also what it does is that the relational impact that comes with it, in that it strengthened, it strengthened, English bundles. So the family has would have like strength, and I think just in terms of like the relationship, and I think just the supportive network as well, if there is communication, because then family members would know that they can rely on each other. And I think as well, another important part of it is that it influences the success of the rehabilitation process. I think oftentimes we usually then encourage patients to be as honest as possible while offering, you know, that space that is like safe. And I think that's what we often tell them, even when they start therapy, that this is your safe space. So we encourage that you are open enough, because if there is an openness, and, you know, they're not like trusting of us, then they won't be able to like heal fully, because we won't even know what to assist them with. So I think that's those are some of the things that you know, communication assist with. But I think just in addition to that, I think it's also important to understand that as far as communication is concerned, if family members, including the loved one that is in recovery, are communicating, they're able to even address underlying issues, because oftentimes we would say that addiction is a big thing, right? But oftentimes it's just the top of the iceberg, but there's so much that's happening either in the family system, or you know, from childhood, or relationship wise. So I think you're able to communicate that, obviously, if there's like healthy communication. But I think with communication, there's so much more that can happen, in a sense that you know, there is that rebuilding of emotional bonds, because you'd find that there's like so many wounds that are currently existing, or there's emotional strain in the family bond that haven't been addressed, you know. And I think with communication, that can be addressed, whether it's fear, whether it's like sadness, whether it's loss. I think there's just a lot that currently that takes place when things are not communicated. And I think just in addition to that, I think just oftentimes there would be family dynamics that are existing, and a lot of times things are not like spoken. And I think it on its own can have like a way to get into someone, and, you know, and impact them negatively, whether emotionally or psychological. And some, for example, if there is by family dynamics, I mean, like, if there is like a family conflict, and constantly things are shoved under the carpet, you know, there isn't that expression of emotion that, okay, for instance, when you saw mom and dad fight, for instance, how did that make you feel, you know? So things are not like discussed in the family, and that can create like an emotional wound that I think can, I think, explode if not addressed. And Yeah, I think it's very, very, very important to take note of the role of communication, because I think it does create that supportive environment for individuals in rehab, as well as just building those trusting relationships with family members. So I think then that leads us to understanding various communication styles. But what are communication styles? So communication styles are a manner in which individuals convey and interpret messages, and we have different types of communication styles. So the first one is passive communication style. So with this one, an individual would avoid expressing their needs or feelings, leading to a lot of resentment. And I think it's the example that I gave earlier, that oftentimes, a family member would like post a status, whether on WhatsApp or on Facebook, and assume that the other family member would like see it. But that's passive, because you're not literally addressing it and facing the person that you would want to communicate with. And I think that can bring, like, obviously a lot of like resentment. And I think oftentimes then the effect of passive communication is that it may result in misunderstandings. And I mean, also the issues may remain unaddressed, because you're not communicating with me directly. You're doing it passively, so, and you can assume that I'm going to understand, hear you. And another one is aggressive communication. So this one, an individual in the family expresses needs, their needs or desires, in a way that violates others. And I think this one is so interesting, Cheryl, because oftentimes then what you see when it happens is that it leads to further conflict in the family. And I think what we see then is that there's further damage, because in a way that you're communicating, you're literally telling me what is it that you want. You're not willing to hear how I feel about that. So I think it just leads to further damage. And then we also have assertive communication. So this one, and a family member would be able to clearly and respectfully express their needs and feelings, meaning that you're also almost like taking into consideration how that will make the next person feel. And I think that's part of respecting as well. And I think it's so interesting with assertive communication, in the sense that the effect for that is that not only does it foster healthy relationship, because isn't it that not is it's not only about you, you're willing to hear me. So we hearing each other, basically. So I think it definitely can foster healthy relationship, and it also promotes understanding as well in family relationship, or even like just relationships generally. And if I'm hearing you and you're hearing me, isn't it that how easy would that be for us to resolve conflicts together effectively, because we're both hearing each other, right? And we have another one, which is passive aggressive. So this one in particular, an individual would indirectly express anger or frustration. And I think this one we should definitely be cautious on as well, in the sense that the results of that can often lead to confusion as well as unresolved issues. For instance, if you are gonna, maybe let's say I'm a child at home and we're having issues, I'm using substances, but instead of you talking to me directly, you go to a neighbor and you say all your frustration and your anger. It's not wrong, but do you have a problem with a loved one, or do you have a problem with me? So see, I'm not hearing that. I'm not understanding that this is bringing you frustration, this is bringing you anger. So as a result, obviously, that's going to bring further confusion, and whatever issues that we have are going to continue to be unresolved. So I think it's so important for family members to, just understand these communication styles. And I think just also recognizing your communication patterns that you're already using, and its effects as well on your communication with your loved one, because I think it is very crucial. I can't stress it enough, Cheryl.
I agree. I'd like to just add something to the passive part because I think this is where we hear people say, no, but he's easygoing. He doesn't cause too much drama in the house. I don't know where it came from. And the aggressive we can shy away from because that's sort of loud and in your face. But like I'm more worried when I deal with a passive or a passive aggressive person, whether it's the family or the loved ones, because sorry, I'm just gonna let somebody in. Okay, done. Because as I said, the loud is noticeable. And I think for us, where we see passive aggressive is often in the families. That's often a style that families are a lot more comfortable to use. So when we do conjoints, the family will say, yes, your drinking did get to me a little bit. When you didn't come home, it worried me. Instead of being really honest and saying, I never slept that night. I don't trust you. It shattered me. It's broken our family. That's what the work we do in treatment with them, and that's how we're trying to encourage you guys as families to disengage from either the passive, the aggressive, or the passive aggressive style of communication.
Definitely agree with you. I think it's important for families to really think about how they communicate with their loved one and reevaluate and, try to think about making those adjustments. I think, like you're saying, certain things that they need to hear. A lot of things I think they might have mentioned to them when they were not like sober, probably intoxicated, but now I think they're in a space where they're able to like hear in a sober state of mind. And we are there to help them process everything as well and to offer support. So I think it's really important for families to be mindful of that as well. So there are significant benefits to assertive communication in a sense that the characteristic for assertive communication is that you become clear and direct. You're not talking through a neighbor or talking, through WhatsApp or Facebook and assuming that, a loved one will know. And I think it's respectful and empathic in a sense that it acknowledges and respects the next person's rights and opinions. So meaning that the next person feels heard and understood as well. And I think it becomes like an open dialogue. And I think that and on its own encourages just a healthy exchange and just healthy problem-solving skills as well. So I think just benefits for that is that it decreases misunderstandings and fights. Because you're hearing me, I'm hearing you. So it's easy for us to come with a solution rather than to wait until things escalate to like a physical. And I think it also just built trust and mutual respect because I don't feel like I'm underneath you. Even if your mom, but you're willing to like hear me as your son or as your daughter. And I know that it can be something that's like quite difficult. And you also agree with me, Cheryl, in a sense that how do I listen to a child that has hurt me? How do I communicate effectively and assertively with someone that has stolen from me? That's hard, but I think we're just seeing how beneficial that would be for just the family. And I think that as well, it promotes understanding and support, especially in the loved one's recovery process as well. So I think just in a nutshell, just if you're able to assertively communicate, it also just helps you to express your needs and feelings without causing conflict or harming relationship, which I think is vital for recovery.
Yeah, and I think a practical guide we can give now is you'll hear us say live just for today. Live in the now, deal with the now. And if the families can take that into consideration and say, okay, this child has hurt me, destroyed my life, but that's in the past. For now, I'm going to try a new style of communicating, hearing, not interrupting, not liking what I hear, but taking it in. And practice that more regularly. And then what doesn't get rectified in that can be dealt with in family therapy down the line. Because if we go into their recovery with all this baggage, it's going to be impossible to interact in an assertive or kind or respectful way. So I think, this is vital. For me, this is key on how to start healing the family relationships.
Definitely agree with you, and I think that's what you were saying earlier, where you said that honest communication, because I think when families become honest to us during those conjoints, I think that's where real healing starts to happen.
Yeah.
Because if you're gonna conceal their behavior and be too nice, we're not saying be rude, but I think just like being honest, we are able to help appropriately and address all those things that have happened, and just for them to be able to hear that and reflect on what is it that they've had and how they've had the family, I think it's very, very significant. Because I think
Yeah.
that's part of the emotional impact of how addiction escalates and how you affect your loved ones. So
Correct.
if they don't hear that, I think it becomes difficult to start healing, because the
Correct,
families
yeah.
are not helping as well in being honest.
Yeah.
So we are gonna move to psychological theories that are relevant to communication, and the first one is cognitive behavioral therapy. So this one mainly focuses on modifying negative thought patterns to improve communication. And I think I'll just use an example. So with this one, I think we use it a lot, like in therapy, but I think it's something that can be applicable as well, just in communication with your loved one and in the family system, right? In a sense that I think when we do, for instance, cognitive restructuring, we have what we call cognitive distortion. I think one of the cognitive distortion that I will mention is, for instance, overgeneralization. So one of the family member would, for instance, say that you have stolen before and you'll always be a thief. And you'd find that that has probably happened once or twice, but then now we are generalizing. So that on its own, it's an irrational, I think, style of thinking, right? And but I think that if it's not communicated that, okay, you've done this before, and I'm open to seeing how your change behavior is going to play out, so that I don't generalize. Because isn't it that show we always say that the best apology is changed behavior. So I think a lot of it has to come from the patient, but I think the family members must also be open to seeing that change without already thinking ahead or jumping into conclusion. I think that can obviously cause significant problems. And I think when that is communicated, it helps a lot. And I think positive reinforcement as well. And I think this particular model can help family members address and alter negative thoughts that they have about each other. Like, for instance, if, for instance, that person is known to constantly like steal, that's something that can be communicative, that, you know what, I don't trust you because you've done this before. Rather than saying that, jumping into conclusion already that you've done this, because I think that can come across as like quite harsh. And I think even with the progress that they've made, whether in therapy or in treatment, they can just feel like, they're bad people. So all we're saying is that I think it's important for families to also meet us halfway, because yes, we are with them now, but there will be a time where they go back home. And I think it's important that we all hear and learning about this, so that we know how to approach certain conversation. Even if they've done certain things, doesn't mean that they now have to constantly be reminded that, okay, if something gets missing, it's you, you know. So I think that's like very, very important. So it helps family members address and alter negative thought patterns that impact their communication. And what we also have is attachment theory. So I'd say it focuses mainly on early relationship patterns that shape communication styles. So we usually say that I think childhood, or a lot of things that happen in childhood, has a significant impact on how an individual engages with either the loved one or in the community or even in the family. So some of those attachment style is secure, anxious, avoidant, and disorganized attachment style. So for instance, with a secure attachment style individual, so they might find it easy to communicate or like engage in an open and supportive communication. And I think with that one, it then like facilitate their recovery. It's able to facilitate their recovery and strengthen just relationships as well. So it become easy because they're already secure and like confident in themselves. Whereas if they have anxious attachment already, they come in very like anxious. And I think what we might see, especially in groups, Cheryl, is that they come very, very anxious, and they seek assurance, reassurance. I think even when we do assessment, they would go like, I'm not good at this. So that constant reassurance, either from a therapist or a counselor. So they come very like fearful. But I think part of what we do is to create that safe space and normalize those feelings and help them to get through the program. And I think what we would also see is the avoidant attachment style. So with this one, they may need oftentimes encouragement to open up and engage more fully in the recovery process as well as in family communication. And I think it's important for us to pay attention to these attachment style, because not only does it play out in recovery, it also plays out in the family as well, in terms of how they communicate. Because you can have, for instance, five kids, right? But they won't be the same. And that also depends on whether it's the first one, the middle one, and the or the third one. But they won't communicate the same. They won't behave the same. You know which one communicates how. The other one externalizes. The other one probably internalizes a lot. The other one is a shy one. So I think it is important to pay attention in terms of like how your loved one communicates. And then we have a disorganized attachment style. So with this one in particular, I think the loved one, if they have like a disorganized attachment style, they may require specialized support, either to address conflict, because in terms of how they address conflict, it's so disorganized, right? And I think with that happening as well, they're able to develop like more stable communication pattern, because how they communicate is quite abrupt. So I think it's important for family members to understand attachment style in order to just improve those interaction and responses in family dynamics. I think we'll go straight to the biopsychosocial model. I think it explains itself in a sense that I think if we break it down, there's the biological and the psychological part of it, as well as the social. And I think part of what we do here, Cheryl, we make sure that we deal with the love your loved one holistically and address all these aspects. But I think just in relation to what biopsychosocial model is, it is an integrative model considering biological, psychological, and social factors in health and in illness. Because you remember we did say that addiction is a family disease or illness rather, because it affects different parts of the family and the system on its own, right? And we know that with the system, if one subsystem or system of the family is impacted, the whole system is impacted. And I think that's quite important for us to understand that as well. That's why we have these meetings, so that while the loved one is making changes, we also are making those changes and are learning about addiction in terms of how we can best support them. So some components of a biopsychosocial model, the biological aspect of it, is talks about the physiological impact on communication. And some of that could be stress or biochemical changes. For instance, if someone is stressed, are they able to communicate effectively? Or how does that impact their communication? Some people, obviously react to stress differently, and I think it differs from person to person. The other person can just say, you know what, I want to be by myself, and the other one can express that differently, in a very I think, expressive way, whereby they act out their stress. And I think that's where a lot of times we see projection of emotions, Cheryl, where a loved one would maybe was made angry by someone, and then they project that to family members. So I think I'll give like a practical one. Maybe they don't have money to buy their drug of choice, and what they do is that they project that frustration, that anger to the family members. And the family member would be surprised what's happening. It's not like I did anything to you, but I think it's part of the stress that probably comes with that. And I think the other one is psychological, which is mental health issues affecting communication. That could be anxiety and depression. I think we see that a lot also in treatment, in a sense that when a patient or a loved one is struggling to communicate how they're feeling, or they're constantly anxious or preoccupied, ruminating about a lot of like things, or anxious about the future, because I think oftentimes what we'd see, Cheryl, is that immediately when they start, they would be like, I'm worried about my family, I'm worried about my job. And I think that might impede the communication, whether in therapy, whether in group, or whether even with families, right? Because they're not able to be fully present where they are in the here and now, just for today. And I think even depression as well, because with a loved one being depressed, they isolate, they become so sad, the mood as well changes, so they're not able to fully communicate how they're feeling. But also social factors, so the social influence of family dynamics or societal norms and support system. I think also I'll just touch on the societal norms, for instance. I think it's something that could impede on communication or hinder the patient or the loved one to be fully to fully be able to communicate what is it that they're feeling. For instance, I think I'll give this example. I know that there are maybe, for instance, cultures where a loved one can, for instance, use hands to communicate or to express themselves, or like look the person in the eye to communicate, because that might be deemed as disrespectful or not respecting. But I think part of you being able to assert yourself, and of course people communicate different, and perhaps when I use my hands I become less anxious, or perhaps when I use my hands is me trying to make sense of whatever that I'm explaining. And I think the next person being able to understand that, I'm able to then communicate, and I understand that it can be difficult for obviously other cultures, but I think it's something to also be aware of as family members, that it's something that can also hinder communication. So yeah, I think it's important for us to just like be aware that, you know, there are like some biopsychosocial stuff that can hinder just our interaction or communication. But I think when we recognize these things, we're able to, you know, just create that comprehensive support strategy for individuals or loved ones. So, just in relation to what are effective communication strategies for family members, I think that includes active listening. And you might wonder, how do I actively listen to my loved one, you know? And I think that could be reflective listening. And I think we try a lot as well to model for families during our conjoint when it comes to reflective listening, whereby in our first conjoint, the family would obviously share how the loved one has impacted them. And then we obviously allow the loved one to reflect what is it that they had, because I think there's something powerful about that. Like I said earlier, that you might have mentioned this when the individual was intoxicated or was not yet in treatment. And I think when that happens, I think it's so powerful, because now the it's like the mind is clear, they're on medication, they're in already in therapy. I think it's really, really important. So they're able to reflect what is it that they had and how they've impacted the family as well. So I think another one is paraphrasing, you know, and you know, just summarizing and asking open-ended question, not, you know, closed-ended question, the yes and no. So I think the main reason or purpose for active listening is that it ensures understanding and shows empathy, that you're actually understanding what I'm saying. So I think it's very, very important. And I think another point is empathy, in a sense that how you can you know, just show empathy is that you can show genuine care. You don't have to like pretend. And validate their feelings without judgment. I think that's the biggest thing, because oftentimes they come to treatment already having these preconceived ideas that they're being judged. It's normal to have shame. It's normal to have the guilt, because I think for us hearing that, it actually means that you're internalizing what you've done from to your family. So I think it's quite important. And I think that it's important in that it helps build trust and support, and that just support emotional needs as well. And I mean, if I feel heard, I feel understood, I feel supported, I'm not like dismissed. Next time when I'm having, you know, an emotional turmoil, I'm able to come back. And I think setting boundaries, I think this one show in every present, almost every presentation, we are always bringing it for, because it's so important, right? So here you establish those clear and healthy limits, you know, and I think the benefits for this is that it just helps in maintaining a personal well-being, and it also just creates that structured environment. So I think it's important for us to understand that just applying these strategies, it helps the family system to effectively you know, support their loved ones by fostering, you know, openness, empathic and empathicness and just respectful communication while also maintaining their own well-being as well. So of course there are communication barriers that often like stand in the way, but how do you overcome those communication barriers and some of the emotion what's this common barriers is emotional reactions such as anger, frustration, or sadness affecting interaction. That could be some of the barriers because like for instance if someone is angry and the next let's say a family member is angry and the loved one is also angry, are we going to be able to communicate? We're not going to hear each other. So that's why we often encourage that and I think we part of what we do is working on just communication and anger management. How do you respond? When do you respond? Does it mean when you step back and communicate with a loved one, when emotions are much more on a lower level, does it mean that, ma'am, you're too stupid? No. It just means that you're able to regulate emotion and you know when to communicate. And when you do communicate, when emotions are like now down, not escalated, we're able to hear each other. So, misunderstandings, lack of clarity or assumptions leading to conflict. And I think sometimes it's just important to just clarify if you didn't hear someone properly, you might have, I don't know, not been focusing clearly, or you misunderstood them. Just ask for clarity. And I think defensive behavior, it's one of the barrier to communication because I think oftentimes with defensive behavior, a family member or a loved one, for instance, might be already be ready to react. And I think it says here reactivity or withdrawal, obstructing effective communication. I mean, if I'm communicating with you and you're already jumping and saying that, you know what, I didn't do this, or it's not me, I'm all fists on you, how is that helpful? It's not helpful at all because you're being defensive. How about you listen, sit back, and hear me? And some of the solutions to that is using I statements, expressing feelings without blaming others. And I think practice self-regulation. I think I spoke about this earlier, which is being able to communicate when you are in a more calm and clear state of mind, because then you'll be able to articulate whatever that you want to communicate properly. And seek clarification, whereby you'll be able to address and resolve those understanding properly. So I think yeah, it's quite important for us to also realize that communication is not easy, but once we learn about it and how we should communicate, and practical ways to do that in terms of like dealing with the barriers to communication. Think that can be very, very helpful for families. And I think it's important for families, I think, because obviously barriers might be different from family to family. So identifying those barriers, I think it would be important. And I think it would be interesting to hear, I think, at the end of the presentation, what those barriers are for you. But I think if you are able to identify those barriers, then you're able to figure out a way to overcome them in order to just ensure that more effective communication, which I think would help in preventing those conflicts as well. And then we have practical exercises for families. And this is role playing, whereby you practice common scenarios to improve communication skills, communication journal, an activity could be documenting daily interaction and reflecting on communication patterns that we were talking about earlier, and just feedback sessions. And I think this one, an activity could be regular, regularly discussing communication experiences, either with your therapist or even support groups like these ones. And I think that way you're able to, just gain insights and advice for
Yeah.
better communication and, practices. Yeah, I think just one last thing, just in relation to those exercises from earlier, I think it's important for families to, try engaging in these exercises, because I think it also just allow family members to, just not only practice but refine their communication skills that are already existing, and also maybe to enhance, so do necessary adjustments, because no one is perfect, we never stop learning. So some of the resources that I have for us is the assertiveness workbook, which you can find online by Randy J. Peterson, and Communication Skills for Dummies by Elizabeth Cooney. Thank you, everyone. Any questions, any reflections from family members?
I think presentations like this bring up a lot for everybody. Because I think one of our first go-to is where did I go wrong? I didn't learn how to communicate. I didn't teach my child how to communicate, or my parents didn't teach us how to communicate. And I think for tonight's purpose, try and put that aside for everybody that is present, on this platform, and look at the practical tips that Sibongile's given us. Because it's got to start somewhere. I think it's one of those things that, when he gets better, I'll learn how to talk to him. Or if he gets clean, I'll learn how to talk to him. Or if she listens to me, I'll learn how to talk to her. And what you were saying is, no, it's got to start somewhere. And now's a good time to start. And I get it. I think it's one of the most difficult things to talk to somebody who's really upset you, and I often say, rehab is time for the families to have a bit of a breather while the loved one gets treatment, but only a day or two. Then you've got to start working on yourselves, because 3 weeks is not a long time. If you're blessed enough to go into long-term treatment, that really does help, because I think time does heal quite a few things. But time's not going to sort this one out. This is the work that we as families are obligated to do. And I think we can start it on the phone calls. Remember, we listen to the phone calls and we get feedback from the phone calls. So we hear your side of it and their side of it. And sometimes it's a miracle that everybody likes each other still and they're still talking. And then they'll have a huge big argument on Tuesday night, but tuck money will be paid in on Wednesday. And that's another way that people try and communicate, with demonstration. And we're saying, let's stay away from the demonstrative stuff and talk. Learn how to verbally tell them what you're feeling. And we do teach your loved ones as well. They forget it most of the time, but it starts with, I feel when you. And I would prefer it if. So it keeps it quite constrained in that. So I feel angry when you manipulate me. I would prefer it if you could just speak a bit more clearly. Or I feel disillusioned when you keep on relapsing. I would prefer it if you make a decision and stick to it. So it's very concise, and it's not about blame, and it doesn't get into the drama triangle of, he said, she said, victim, rescue, persecute. I feel when you, and I would prefer it if.
I think we have another question from Cindy. She's saying, I'm finding it difficult to communicate and set boundaries to my loved one who is in recovery but does not stay with me. He says he's fine, but how will I know if he no longer is?
I think that's such a crucial question, right? And I think we get asked it majority of the time. I don't think it makes a difference where people live. I think it's a relationship. So it's an engagement between two people. And I think it depends on what your personal boundaries are. Because my personal boundaries, I won't talk to a drunk person. So even at work, when somebody comes in drunk, I don't spend lots of time talking to them. I welcome them. I explain to them, this is what's going to happen. And when they want to talk about their moms and their dads, and say, okay, you know what? We're just going to go to the nurse. We're just going to introduce you to a group. We'll deal with all of that in group and in therapy from tomorrow. So that's my own personal boundary. So I can't then come home and say, oh, I can't stand drunk people. Because I stuck to my own personal boundary. So I think we can set our own boundaries first, and then we can set boundaries for our loved one. And it's quite varied. So you might need to get some help with from a therapist or a counselor or your own therapy, because it's a dynamic. I think we start with saying, look at your behavior. Are you being aggressive, passive aggressive? Are you manipulative? Are you quiet? Are you withdrawing? And because I think we do teach people how to treat us. And I think our loved ones have taught us how they want to be treated. And most of the time, it's leave me alone. Don't talk to me. Don't look at me. Don't notice me. So we spoke a lot. Sibongile spoke a lot about honesty tonight. And I think it is about honesty. It's, I'm finding it difficult to talk to you. I think we need to get some help around it, unless you're okay to not communicate with me. And then take stock of your behavior, because I think sometimes, particularly us as moms, we nag, we get in their face, we repeat, how are you? Did you go to a meeting last night? What are you doing? And that just gets their back up. And then they find it very difficult to communicate. So I think keep your own journal and look at your own behaviors. And then you can take that to a therapist or to a group. And you can slowly but surely pick up your own behavior and your own patterns. My patterns were reactive. I would just react, or it was continually reactive. And when I had to get into recovery, it was, I'm going to act when I need to, but I'm going to listen the rest of the time. And I do that in my personal life and in my professional life. I listen because we hear what they're saying, even in their silences. So sometimes I use the analogy of the opposite of what we think is true. So if we think we've got to get them to communicate, sometimes we don't need to get them to communicate. When their wheels fall off, we'll know.